Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for letting us gather here today, Lord, for the graduating class of 2017. We thank you for the opportunities and experiences and memories, Lord, that we've had throughout these years. We pray, Lord, that as this window is closing, Lord, that you open the door for each one of us. Lord, we pray for this message here today that we're about to receive, that we'll be able to apply and use it in this next journey of our lives. Lord, but most importantly, we thank you for sending your Son, Lord, so that we don't have to go on this journey alone. Lord, and through him, all things are possible. Be with us, watch over us, lead and direct us, Lord. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hold to me like Jesus, there's no one beside you. introduce our speaker today. Philip Graves, you may not know him, but he knows us all well because Ms. Allen has been talking about us for the past 6 years. He's been a pastor for 11 years and is currently the associate pastor at Shiloh Church in Louisville. Please join me in welcoming Pastor Sean Allen.
Well, I do want to say that I am very excited to be here today. I'm kind of surprised, honestly, because most of y'all know that my wife got to receive three Greenlee awards just last week, and it was funny because I asked her. I said, "When you go up and get them, can I do the Arsenio Hall thing when you go up?" And she was like, "Sean, please don't talk when you get there." She said, "Don't talk. Don't look at anybody, don't walk around, just video stuff." So when she asked me to do this, I was like, wow, really? I get to actually talk while in front of everybody. So kind of a surprise. And if I learned one thing at that Greenlee Award, is that if I was you all, I would want Mr. Mills as a teacher as well, because he must be more fun doing than just what I was listening to. So. But, you know, after she asked me to speak, I really did. I stopped and I started praying about it. What could I possibly say to everybody here today? What could I share? What could I say to such an elite group of young men and young women, just business people, somebody going off into life? What can I say to hardworking parents? What can I say to the unmatched staff at Knox Central? And, you know, I don't know about you, but I just want to be better. I want to be a better person. I want to be a better dad. I want to be a better husband. I want to be a better employee. I want to be a better Christ follower. I just want to be better. And in order to do that, we have to be willing to work on our character. We have to be willing to be accountable not only to ourselves, but to everybody that's around us from time to time. And that's why I love kids today. Because kids are honest. And kids are funny. And I don't know about you all, but I don't like to be in a church service that's real stuffy. And I don't like to be in a church service that isn't fun. I believe Jesus was fun. So I thought, what a better way to kick this off than just to show you a couple of letters that I found that some children wrote to some of their teachers. And let me set this first one up. I can't really see this, so I've got these to read to you. This first one's kind of funny because it says a teacher had handed out like a little pamphlet or a little, what do you call those things, a sheet to fill out. And on it it said, if you went to a picnic, who would eat the most at a picnic? And it gave two choices, the mosquito or the dog. Now I want you to check this out. This kid, he said neither. Here's his response. He says, my dad, he's chubby. And he has a problem. Now this next one, it's funny. Some of you all might, Jake, you have missed this. Another one, oh, what's wrong with this? Now check this one out. This was written by a little girl that was writing to her boyfriend. And she says, Sean, I'm breaking up with you. You've not talked to me since the day you asked me out. That was 3 months ago. You need to get it together, or you will never get married, and that would be sad. You should get married, just not to me, Rachel. Some of the parents are probably thinking, man, I think that I might have married Sean. Now, this next one, and I want you to know that Tommy was like, please don't tell that here. And I stopped telling that here. And I just thought it was appropriate because there's a bunch of students in here, there's teachers that are in here, and this student heard that his teacher didn't show up to class because she was sick, so he decided to write her a letter. Listen to this. Dear Mrs. Clark, I heard that you did not feel good. Well, when that happens, here's a trick to learn. Just go cook. I'm not kidding. It works with me every morning I feel bad. So just remember, when you feel bad, the first thing you do is poop. I don't feel good. I've got it. Like, in this kid, like, he's drawing diagrams. Like, he's going to be a doctor one day, right? here's the last one. Now, some of you parents, you probably receive these from your children from time to time. We get these at the church sometimes. But it says, "Dear God, I mean, it's very hard for you to love all of everybody in the whole world. There's only four people in our family, and I can never do it." It's hard being God. You know, I didn't decide to follow Jesus until I was 24 years old. And before that, I was addicted to drugs and alcohol. And I've got a criminal background record that's about 6 pages long. And I'm just going to be honest with you guys this morning. I didn't like church, and I didn't like church people. And the reason is because every time I met somebody that went to church, it seemed like, or I went to a church, they were very religious, and they were mean, and they were self-righteous. But at the age of 24, I went on a 3-day retreat called the Walk to Emmaus. And all the information that I had in my head found its way to my heart. And there is a word in the New Testament that just kind of sparked something new inside of me. And it's the word compassion. Everybody say compassion.
Compassion.
You know, I remember hearing about how Jesus was born into this brutal world. And at that time, the Roman military was ruling over it. And the Roman military made ISIS seem pleasant. They made terrorists seem like law-abiding citizens at that time. So Jesus was up against the wall. And Jesus didn't fight with swords and shields. He fought using compassion. And when you look up that word in the Greek, it literally means to feel the pain in your stomach. It means that when you see someone else hurting, you hurt for them. In other words, Jesus was burdened for this world far before he ever died for it. And as a pastor, one of the things that I do is I conduct funerals from time to time. And at a funeral, you can watch an interesting social dynamic take place. You know those normal physical boundaries that we have, like our safe space? At a funeral, they go away. Because when you see someone hurting, you hurt with them. So understanding that, I saw a pastor do this some time ago, and I thought, man, that'd be a good idea. And I know how much people hurt, so I got one of the guys from the church to go with me downtown in Pineville. Several years ago, I'll never forget that I made a sign and it said, "Free hugs." And we stood out on the corner there in Pineville, and I remember people would walk by, but I'll never forget the first guy that began to make his way across the road from over at the courthouse. And as he got about halfway, I remember he got close enough where he could see me, and I watched his eyebrows raise. And I was like, I don't know if he's coming in for the kill. I don't know what he's going to say. And he looked at me and he's like, "Oh, I thought that said free hogs." And I was like, only in Kentucky would somebody think that we're giving away free livestock downtown in the square. But I also serve at a drug rehab center twice a week. And just a couple of weeks ago, we had a guy come through all the way from Louisville. I've got a picture because I kind of want you to see who he is. His name was Jazz. But one of the first things that I noticed about Jazz when he came through is that he had on this pair of Jordan slippers. And when I began to notice them, I noticed that they were completely worn out. And he actually had one side of one of them like laced up and kind of like sewn together with the shoelace. And automatically my heart went out to him. And I began to feel compassion for him. So I thought, I've got seven pair of shoes at home, and they're all in good shape. I don't even wear half of them. So Tony and I, we went out and we bought him a new pair of those Jordan slip-ons. And when I got back to the center, I laid him up on his bunk. And when he came into his room, he saw him, and he came straight to me to thank me. And when he got to me, I got him, and I just grabbed him up. And he said, "I want to thank you." He said, "Man, it's been a long time since someone's done something like that for me." And I said, "Jazz, that is exactly what Jesus would have done." And I remember as I grabbed him and I hugged him, he immediately began to cry. And he said, "It's been a long time since someone hugged me like that." Listen, when nobody hugs you, you begin to feel like a nobody. But I'm here to remind you that nobody is a nobody. nobody to God. And in Mark chapter 10, we find someone that actually feels like a nobody. And in verse 46, we're introduced to a man by the name of Bartimaeus, which means son of honor. And I want you to listen to what it says here. It says, then they reached Jericho, and as Jesus and his disciples left town, a large crowd followed him. And I want to pause there just to say that you see that phrase all through the scripture, a large crowd followed him. And I want you to know that if Jesus was here today, the same thing would be going on. A large crowd would be following him everywhere that he went. It goes on to say a blind beggar named Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting beside the road. And when Bartimaeus heard that Jesus of Nazareth was nearby, he began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And isn't this just like religious people? They look at him and they say, be quiet. Hush up. But I love what Bartimaeus done. It says that he got even louder. And he said, son of David, have mercy on me. And when Jesus heard him, he stopped and he said, tell him to come here. So they called out to the blind man, saying, Bartimaeus, cheer up. Jesus, he's calling to you. Come, go to him. So Bartimaeus threw aside his coat, he jumped up, and he came to Jesus. What do you want me to do for you, Jesus asked. He said, teacher, he said, I want to see. And Jesus said, go, for your faith has healed you. And instantly the man could see, and he followed Jesus down the road. If I could pull two questions from the scripture that I just read to you, it would be two questions that Bartimaeus was asking, and I believe it's two questions that people all around us today are asking. It's people that you're going to run into in your life, and they're going to be asking these same questions. It's people for the adults that are here. It's people that are around you at work, around you at school, at home even sometimes, and they're asking these same questions. And here it is. Can you see me? And can you help me? And I understand a lot of you are getting ready to go off to college. Others are getting ready to go off into the workforce. But the worst thing that you can do is isolate yourself. And that's exactly what Bartimaeus was doing. He was isolated from people. And he's shouting, he said, can anyone see me? And does anyone love me enough to help me? And we have people all around us asking those same questions every day. You know, there's this powerful chemical that's released in our brains called dopamine. And when it's released, it causes us to feel good. And studies have shown that you can relate these little things that most of us carry around to this. Research shows that when we receive a text message or an email or somebody likes something that we posted to social media, that it releases high levels of dopamine. It makes us feel good when we're sad or we're stressed out. And that's why we're constantly always pulling these things out and looking at them. Now here's another interesting fact. Dopamine is also released when you gamble, when you smoke, and when you drink. And years ago, we placed age-restricting laws on gambling, smoking, and drinking because we recognized that those things were addictive, and yet there is no age-restricting law on the cell phones and the things that we carry around in our pockets today. As a matter of fact, research shows that if you hand one of these to a child that is scared, stressed, or afraid, that it's almost like handing him a bottle of whiskey and saying, hey man, figure it out. Research also shows that people who use Facebook, and I am one of those, are more likely to be depressed and discouraged than people who don't use it. Why? Because the dopamine wears off. And the only thing that can satisfy us is human-to-human interaction or affection or attention. And I'm just going to submit to you that we need less thumb-to-thumb interaction and more face-to-face interaction today. And if you want to know if you're addicted to these things, they said that if you're sitting in a meeting with a group of people and you're compelled to pull this out, that's addiction. And addiction always leads to isolation. And isolation always causes us to feel that empty feeling that we feel inside, that causes us to ask the question, do I matter? Does anyone see me? Does anyone love me enough to help me? These are the questions that Bartimaeus is asking. And Jesus answers twice saying, hey, I see you, and I want to help you. So I want to ask you to do something with me. I want to ask you, I'm going to rattle off some things, and if you know somebody that's been affected by this, or you have personally been affected by this, and you know somebody that has, I'm just going to ask you just for a moment to raise your hand and to keep it up. If you've experienced these stressful things, divorce, bankruptcy, cancer, just raise your hand up. Miscarriage, affair, depression, suicide, addiction, prison, death. Now look around the room. Almost everybody. You lower your hands. So what does that mean? It means one thing. It means that we're all hurting. And we're all healing. Every single one of us in this room, we are hurting or healing in some way. If you're here today, if you've got people around you, you've got people to heal with. Now here's the thing. There's people all around us today that are hurting all by themselves. And they need somebody to come alongside of them to help them heal. Some of the same compassion that Jesus shows us as he walks throughout the scripture. They're just like Bartimaeus. They're struggling, and they're looking for something to help them, and if they do not find it, you know what they do? They'll numb it, or they'll hide it, or they'll take it out on someone else. And we want people to know that healing is available for them. Because I think that we all know what it's like to hurt. Let me say it like this. There was a mother who had a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old, and she took that 2-year-old and 4-year-old, and she set them on the couch together. She turned on the television, the cartoon. She gave them a bowl of those little goldfish. And after she got them all set up, she had some laundry to fold. So she made her way off into the laundry room, and she began to fold laundry. And it wasn't long until she heard screaming coming from the living room. So she made her way back to the living room, and the first thing she saw is her 2-year-old is standing over top of her 4-year-old, and he's just pulling at his hair. And that 4-year-old's kicking, and he's screaming, and she grabs the 2-year-old, and she sets him to the side, and she says, listen, you can't do that. And she looks at the 4-year-old, and she says, listen, he doesn't understand. He doesn't know what that feels like. So she gets the kids all separated, gets everything straightened back out. She places them back on the couch, cartoons going again, got her goldfish, she goes back into the laundry room. And it's just a few seconds and she hears screaming again. And she rushes out the door again and she looks, and this time the 4-year-old's standing over the 2-year-old and he's just yanking the 2-year-old's hair. And as he turns around and looks at his mom, he said, now he knows how it feels. How many of us wanted to be that brother from time to time? We just wanted somebody to know how it felt. And I love this statement from Jesus. He said in everything, not in some things, not in a few things, he said in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. Now in America, we call this the golden rule, but I want you to notice the genius of Jesus in this moment. He does not frame this up in the negative. Jesus didn't say, don't do to others what you want them to do to you. He's not calling us to be a people that's inactive. He's calling us to be active in other people's lives. He's not telling us to refrain from unkindness. He's calling us to be active in other people's lives. He's saying, listen, you encourage other people because you know what it feels like to be encouraged. He said, you give a compliment to someone else because you know what it feels like to receive a compliment. And Jesus was the best at this. Because he always placed himself in other people's shoes. And he always asked the question, if I was them, that's got cancer, you would say, well, I don't have cancer, but I could. I wasn't born in another country that doesn't have good food and water, but I could have been. You see, that's what compassionate people, they ask. What if it was me? What would I want someone to do for me? A high school teacher. I thought this was interesting. A high school teacher looked at her class and she said, what I want you all to do is I'm going to give you 1 minute to write down all the names of the students that you do not like on a piece of paper. And most of the students only wrote one or two names. But there were a couple of kids that wrote more than 14 names. Now what that showed is that the students that wrote the most names were themselves the most disliked. And this is called the echo effect, and most everybody understands this, and they know that if you take yourself and you go and you stand on the edge of a canyon, and you yell out, I love you, you're going to hear, I love you, I love you, I love you. But if you go and you stand on the edge of the same canyon, and you yell out, I hate you, it's going to come back. It's a biblical principle. You reap what you sow. So if you want to reap love, you've got to sow love. Let's compare it like this. This happened not long ago, and it's crazy, but 30 in Chicago, 30 adults, not three, 30 adults got in a fist fight at Chuck E. Cheese trying to get a prize from the prize counter. Now listen, I understand that. I've been to Chuck E. Cheese. I wanted to throw a couple of jabs once or twice myself. But knowing the golden rule and applying the golden rule are two different things. Now let's compare that to what happened in Texas just a little while ago at Chick-fil-A. One guy decides to pay for the car behind him. So he pulls out, the next car pulls up, the teenager working at the counter says, hey listen, the car in front of you paid for your food. So he decided to pay for the car behind him. Now this is crazy, but 228 consecutive cars paid for each other. Now car 229, maybe he should have drove to Chicago. I'm down at Chuck E. Cheese that morning. Still Chick-fil-A. So knowing the golden rule and applying the golden rule are two totally separate, different things. And maybe you'll recognize this, but kindness will breed kindness. And I love this verse, and I took it from the Message because I love the way it said it. In Romans 2:10, it says, in kindness, God takes us firmly by the hand and leads us into a radical life change. Now I want to say something to everybody in this room, because I understand that some of you here may have grew up in a church where you were told that the Father wasn't like that. Or at least you got that feeling by the time you lived. And you were told that the Father was angry at you, and you always felt like God was just disappointed in you, and you had to be perfect before you went before God. But you know what changed that for me? Because if you remember, I told you I didn't even like church people before I got saved. I didn't like church before I got saved. I'll tell you what changed it for me. I got away from the religious crowd, and I met a bunch of people that just really Jesus. And they understood his character, and they understood the compassion of Christ, and they imitated it in their life. And I found a church that said it was okay for people just to walk in all jacked up with a bunch of problems and not understanding whether they should go left or right. And they were just glad to see me, and they just celebrated the fact that I was actually in church that morning. Changed my whole life. They didn't see me for where I was. They saw me for where I could be. And I think that's just like Jesus. And I want you to understand something today. People who were nothing like Jesus, like Jesus. And Jesus liked people who were nothing, who was nothing like him. And I love the fact that no matter who you are, no matter what you've done last month, or no matter what you've done last week, or no matter what trips. I know you do because you took a video and you sent it to everybody that you know. But I want to break it to you, your kid didn't run and walk. They kind of fell forward. It was a controlled fall. But they took two steps and you couldn't wait to tell everybody, hey, they walked, they done it, they finally done it. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sure that none of us in this room, when your child failed, I don't believe that any of us, including myself, would have ran in and swooped our kid up and looked at them and said, hey, this is the Jackson family, and we don't do that around here. You're going to walk, let me tell you something, if you fall one more time, you're out of the house. I mean, none of us would have done that. I mean, because that would have been a cruel parent. And yet, we've been doing that in the church for years. That's why I'm glad I found a place that created an environment that said, oh wow, you took two steps, hey, get back up, we're going to celebrate the two steps that you took. And then if you fall again, you'll take three next time, and we'll celebrate those three steps. And if you fall, we'll help you back up, and we'll celebrate the four steps that you take next time. We need to be a people that celebrates progress instead of beating people up when they mess up. Now you might say, well, preacher, that illustration works good for kids, but what about adults? Well, adults fall too. And if you're in here and you're an adult and you've never fell down, welcome to earth, because you're an alien and we don't even know what planet you're from today. We fall down. Proverbs 24, verse 16 says, the righteous fall seven times, and yet they rise again. So if you've fallen this past month, or you've fallen this past week, or if you fell last night, get back up. Or here's something even better. If you see somebody who has fallen, help them back up. You see, I've got a dilemma. I've got a dilemma for every single one of you seniors today. I've got a dilemma for every one of the adults and the family members that showed up today. Because see, what I want to see is I want to see you stuck in the middle. But you see, the middle is a place that most people don't like to be. And in most cases, the middle is avoided. Because see, when you're in the middle and you've got something on both sides of you, you've got tension. And you've got something pulling you left and pulling you right. So when you're in the middle, it means you're kind of neutral. You feel like you should be somewhere else. And I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but the attack of the enemy is to get you to pick a side. And Sunday is the most sacred day of the week. Because the enemy has us picking a side. You know, I think in the church we want everybody to believe and feel like we would accept anybody. And we say that from time to time, but when it happens, when somebody gets, sometimes they don't really get accepted. And we want people to believe that we're not racist until the media throws up Black Lives Matter, or All Lives Matter, or Blue Lives Matter. You see, we love our brothers and sisters until the political party begins to raise its head up. And now we have the Bloods and the Crips, otherwise known as the Democrats and the Republicans today. You see, white people had gangs long before the Mexicans and the blacks did. And the same thing's going on inside of our churches today. Because you're either Pentecostal or Baptist. And I would suggest that maybe we just need to be stuck in the middle. Because in Joshua chapter 3, the children of Israel are getting ready to cross over into the promised land. And the Bible says that the priest walked out before the people. And in verse 17, it says this. It says, meanwhile, as the priests were carrying the Ark of the Covenant, they stood in the middle of the riverbed and they let the people pass by. They stood there until all of Israel made it to the other side. And I'm telling you, there is something powerful when we choose to just stand in the middle. I mean, can you imagine for just a moment? Hey, we're not talking about just a couple of people. We're talking about like 2 million people had to cross by and see the promise for people, the people who were carrying the presence, could even enter in. Now, what most of us do is we think that we're leading people when we pick a side. But we're really leading people. You see, when we're stuck in the middle, there is a constant tension on us because we don't want to offend people. And I used to be the kind of preacher that thought, I want to offend somebody. I don't care if I offend somebody. But I quickly learned that's the wrong attitude to have, because as a Christian, we're not called to divide people. We're called to bring them together. So when black people get shot at the hands of a white officer, I've got this tension inside of me because I want to sympathize with the black community, but yet I understand that not all white cops are bad. But every time we pick a side, we divide. Every time we pick a side, we divide people. So I get the political part. And whether you like Donald Trump or not, and I know some of you are like, well, I got stuck with Donald Trump. No. Donald Trump got stuck with me. Because I'm in the middle. And I'm supposed to pray for my president whether I like the president or not. I didn't get stuck with the president. He got stuck with me. And I'm not going to let the enemy divide. I'm not going to let the enemy cause me to pick a side and divide. And I know a lot of you are saying, well, shouldn't we stand for something today? And I would say, well, it's easier to take a stand than it is to be stuck in the middle. Because if you're stuck in the middle, you've got to fight off the urge to say something or to do something. We're supposed to bring things together, not separate things. And every time division happens, it's a byproduct of the enemy. Jesus came to restore. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, Jesus took a stand, and I'm going to stand with Jesus. You're right. You know where Jesus stood? You know where Jesus is standing? In the middle. He was stuck in the middle of an old rugged cross between people that loved him and people that hated him. And you know, he could have come off whenever he wanted to, but he didn't come off because he knew that if he did, it would separate. God the Father placed the Holy Spirit where? In you. In the middle. Because even though we're flawed, he knew that he would finish a good work that he began in you. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he's stuck in the middle. He's not yet in his glory. He's got one hand in heaven and the other hand reaching toward you. And he's saying, I'm not leaving my post. And you might say, what does this have to do with anything? It's got everything to do with character and compassion. Reaching people, not dividing people. And I want you young people to know that when you leave and you get off into the college world and out into the work world, you're going to meet a lot of people that's going to want to try to divide and get you to pick a side. But be like Jesus. Bring people together. Don't separate people. You know, it's the kindness of the Father. It's the patience of the Father that causes us to want to change. So doesn't it make sense that if we're kind to others, even though they might be different, that just maybe that same kindness would lead them to a place that they would want to change to? The Father draws us through His kindness. And here's an observation, and it's my last one. But busyness kills kindness. Busyness kills kindness. And Bartimaeus, he's shouting for help, and the crowd tries to quiet him and say, listen, Jesus is too busy to be bothered by you. But friends, can I tell you today that Jesus is never too busy, and he is never bothered by you. Because because his priority is people. And if we have the heart of God and we call ourselves Christians, our priority will always be people. No matter where they are in life, whether they're on drugs, whether they're divorced or homeless, no matter what they look like, whether they've got gauges in their ears, tattoos on their arms, no matter what they dress like, no matter how far they fall, people should always be our priority. So I want to leave you with a question that Jesus asked Bartimaeus. In verse 51, Jesus simply looked at him and said, "What can I do for you?" You know, too often we assume that we know what another person needs. But love never assumes. Love always asks. So here's my challenge. Here's my challenge to you as students, and my challenge to you as adults. We've got to be intentional. We've got to be intentional about reaching people. We've got to be intentional with our character. We've got to be intentional about going out and finding those people with compassion. So here's my challenge. I want you to find one person that's around you, just one. You get to pick who it is. And ask them what they did. And whatever it is, whether they need somebody to listen to them, somebody to run an errand, whatever it is, just do it. Jesus said, in everything, do to others what you have them do to you. And if you're here today and you don't know Jesus because you had a bad experience with church people or with the church, I just want to stand in their place and say this. I'm sorry. I'm sorry that you ran into somebody that was self-righteous and they made you feel like they were better than you, because there's no truth in it. And just because I'm standing on a platform where I've been in ministry for so many years, can I tell you something? That doesn't make me better than you. God doesn't love me any more than he loves you. And if you've had that experience, I just want to stand in their place and say, I'm sorry. Our lead pastor says this all the time, and it's so true. You don't get good to get God. You get God to get good. Because the heart of God will meet you right where you are with kindness and compassion and say, come. Come be a part. So let's just be like Jesus. The people that we're placed with every day, let's just love them right where they're at. Let's let them see the heart of Christ inside of us. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask everybody that would just to bow your head and close your eyes with me for just a minute. I'm going to pray. But let me ask you something. You might be here today, and this might be the first time that you've even been remotely close to church. And the Jesus that I'm telling you about that came from heaven to earth to pay the penalty for your sin, to give you the freedom that you need, not just in heaven, but now. To free you from maybe the same things that I was free from drug addiction or whatever that may be. That you want it. You want to know that Jesus. So let me just ask this question. I want you to know right now, I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to come hit you and pull you down front. I just want to pray for you. Pray for you right here. But if that's you, you can say, that's me, preacher. I'd love to receive Christ. Would you just raise your hand? Just boldly raise your hand real high with nobody looking around. I just want to pray for you. Father, I love you today. I thank you for who you are in my life. I thank you for who you are in these people's life. And Lord, I just ask today, Father, Lord, that as we move forward, Lord, that we would have your heart. We'd have a heart of compassion. We'd see people right where they are, and we would say, you know, I see them. And what can I do for them? That the golden rule wouldn't be something that we would take as
don't do unto others as we would want them to do to us, but it would be something that would cause us to be asking. That we would take your word and we'd say, I see them, what can I do for them? And that we would do for them just what we want somebody to do for us if we were in that situation. Lord, I pray a blessing over each one of these seniors that are here right now. I pray that, Lord, that you would take them far beyond where their wildest dreams would ever imagine. And Lord, I pray for their parents. Lord, I pray that you would give them a heart of peace as they go off to college in different places. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, for safety to cover them. I pray that everything that their hands touch would be blessed. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would take these seniors that are here today as they go out into the world, and Lord, that they wouldn't be caught up with the pick sides, God, that they would be caught up in the, I'm going to bring people together, God, just like you are. Lord, give us a heart for people. Give us your heart. And Lord, I ask that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this special time together where we can worship you before we graduate. I thank you for the words of Sean, and I just pray that you will follow us through the rest of our lives. Allow us to show kindness as Jesus returns kindness. Help us to live a life that is worthy of you. Help us to glorify you in everything that we do, no matter what we decide to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.